Glad to be here and to be able to worship the Lord and to worship with you. So we want to welcome first-time guests. We're so thankful that you're here in the house with us today. And if you would, if you'd fill out a Connect card, or on the seats in front of you, you'll find a QR code that you could scan. Or if you choose, you could text the word NEW, N-E-W, to 717-500-3575. So we are here to worship the Lord. We are so thankful that He is the Lord God who knows us, who knows everything about us, who sees all things, hears all things, and knows all things. He loves us and He keeps us. Amen. So today we want to worship, and there are so many ways to worship. One of those expressions is through song. So we'll be singing a couple of songs today. We're also going to take communion. And then Pastor Jim's going to bring the word. That's another expression of worship. Not only as he proclaims what he has heard the Lord say for this house, for us, but then as we open up our hearts to really intently listen for what he's saying to us. Amen. And then another way that we worship is offering. So I'm going to come back up at the end and we'll collect offering and then we'll pray. I want to read a scripture. That's another way we worship, is the Psalms. So this is found in Psalms 95, and this is out of the Passion Translation. It says, "Come on, everyone, let's sing for joy to the Lord. Let's shout our loudest praises to our God who saved us. Everyone, come. Meet his face with a thankful heart. Don't hold back your praises. Make him great by your shouts of joy. For the Lord is the greatest of all, King God over all other gods. In one hand he holds the mysteries of the earth, and in the other he holds the highest mountain peaks. He's the owner of every ocean, the engineer and sculptor of earth itself. Come and kneel before the Creator God. Come and bow before the majesty and the mighty God, our majestic maker. For we are those he cares for, and he is the God we worship. So drop everything else and listen to his voice." So I do want to let you know that the altar is open, and it has been dedicated as a place where we meet and hear God, where we commune with him face to face, heart to heart, where we press our ear up against his chest to listen and see what he might show us. Father, we come to you today in the name of Jesus. We thank you for the privilege that we have as your children to come before you and to come close. I am so thankful that according to your word, when we draw near to you, you draw near to us. That you are here in this place, for where two or more are gathered together, you are surely here in our midst, and you are here today. So today we stand in awe and wonder, and we tremble at the majesty and the glory and the holiness of who you are. Receive our worship, and we love you in Jesus' name.
Here this morning. Nate's wearing a shirt that says made in the 80s. I'm pretty sure this song was too. But join us.
Jesus. your Bible says that even if we don't praise him, the rocks will cry out because he's so worthy. But never, somebody say never, never will a rock cry out in my place. Because as long as there's breath in my lungs, there's going to be a praise in my mouth. Come on, somebody. So, Father, we thank you this morning. That great and great are you, Lord. Worthy to be praised, worthy to be worshiped. Great are you, Lord. So we praise your name, Father. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord. So praise the Lord, oh my soul, praise the Lord. Come on, we praise your name, Father. Sing it out. Say praise the Lord, oh my soul. Come on, remind your soul this morning of its purpose. Let's sing it together. Say praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord. All right, come on, church. Just you sing it with all of your heart. Praise the Lord. Say praise. Oh my soul, why don't you praise the Lord? We worship you, oh God. Come on, one more time. So praise the Lord. Take a moment right here in his presence. Father, we thank you that we can't get enough of your presence, enough of your goodness. Father, we thank you that you are in the room with us today. No question about it. You said that when we gathered in your name, you'd be here with us. You said that if we worship you, that you would come and ride on the wings of our worship. So Father, for every need that's represented in the room today, every care, every heartbreak, every burden, every yoke, everything that, Lord, just seems to be weighing us down, Father, right now we submit that at the foot of the cross. And we say, Father, it's not our job to figure it out. It's not our job to carry it. It's not our job to worry about it. It's our job to give you praise. And that is what we will do. We'll lift our voice and we'll lift our hands and we'll praise your holy name, because that's what we were created to do. So Father, right now at the foot of the cross, we lay it down and we say, we will pick it up no more. We'll pick it up no more, because there is no God like Jehovah. There is no one like you. There's no one beside you. There's no one above you. So we lay it at the foot of the cross, Father, and we leave here light and free, living in that overflow, Father, because that's what we were called to do. And we give you praise for it in the mighty name of Jesus. If you believe it, shout amen. Now, if you really, really, really believe it, give two or three people around you a high five and say amen. Amen. So before we move on in our service today, we're going to receive communion together as a church. And if you're new this morning, or you're visiting, or it's your first time in a long time, and you're like, well, am I eligible to receive communion? Yes, we practice open communion here. So if you did not receive an element that looks like this when you came in, just lift up your hand and an usher can get that to you. All right, we got a few over here, gentlemen, some up here. Just keep your hands up and an usher will get that to you. Such a joy for us to come together as a church family and church community and partake of the body and the blood together. And what you hold in your hand is nothing more than a wafer probably produced in a factory and some grape juice. I was talking to one of the ushers this morning and they said, some of them have a kick to them. I said, I know they're not expired. I double checked the dates, but if you get one of those ones that have a little extra, then it must be God trying to tell you something. And just get yourself in check. But Jesus sat with his disciples in the upper room. And I love that he knew there would be a day where he wouldn't be physically present in their midst. And he sat with them and he said, listen, there's going to be a moment I'm not physically in the room with you. But I'm always in the room with you. And he said, what I want you to do is I want you to take some bread and I want you to break it. I want you to remember me. And what I think this does is we did a series of messages a long time ago called Breaking the Fourth Wall. And what it was about is the presence of God is never far away. It's actually always with you. You just don't realize it until you acknowledge it. And I think it was Jesus's command to the disciples reminding them, I'm never far. I'm always right there if you just acknowledge it. If you just stop and say, wow, he's with me now. So he took the bread and he broke it and he said, this is my body that represents your healing, broken for you, so that you can have life, abundant life, and eternal life. So Father, we partake of this bread together, this wafer, as the symbol of your body that was broken for us. And we thank you for it. And we acknowledge that you are here in our midst. In Jesus' name, let's partake of that together. The amazing thing about God is his foreknowledge. And he knew that the disciples and the church to come, you and I, we'd fall and we'd mess up and we'd make mistakes. And he said, I've even made provision for that. And all you have to do is when you come together, remember that my blood is enough. Spilled for the remission of your sins. And if you're in the room today and you say, man, I don't know about all that. I've got some heavy sins. I'm here to remind you this morning that the blood of Jesus can cleanse you whiter than the snow if you receive it. So Father, we partake this morning of this juice, which is a representation of the blood that was spilled on the cross. That you would reach forward from Calvary and provide an atonement for our sin. The things that should keep us separated from you, you cover with your blood, and we are forever grateful for that. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's partake. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you, Levi. And you can go ahead and put that on the seat beside you, and can drop that in a bucket when you leave, or get it after church, whatever. Well, you glad to be in church this morning? Amen. So I saw this week that Days of Elijah was on the set list. And I said to Sarah, I don't know, maybe Levi's lost his mind. I don't know what's going on. But did I come in a little bit earlier and just make sure that in the sheet music we doubled the bridge a few times for him because I like that bridge. So good job, guys. That was great. And hey, a few quick announcement before we move on this morning. We're going to be hosting on June 30th worship recording artist Jason Crabb here at Hope City. So if you don't know who Jason Crabb is, from a prolific family of singers, the Crabb family, they started out in Southern Gospel, but he's moved on in Christian music, won several Dove Awards. So he's going to be coming, and Mickey Bell, comedian, is going to be coming on June 30th here at Hope City Church. You excited about that? So tickets will be available this week. Now, they're going to be free tickets, but we do have to get a head count of who's coming because we can only seat so many. And so when they are released, we'll be the first to let you know via email. So make sure you get them and reserve them. Next week, we'll have invites and posters that you can take to let people know that he's coming. But we're ready to pack the place out and have a wonderful night of worship and ministry and laughter. And it's going to be incredible. Amen. And I was a little surprised they're coming to Hope City. He was just at Giant Center not that long ago, and now they're at Hope City. So I don't know, but it's good things. It's good things. We're excited about that. So June 30th, mark that on your calendars. If you have vacation, just move it, and just tell them your pastor said so. All right. So I just want to keep you aware of that. Amen? All right. So we're going to jump into a sermon today. That's talking about changing our beliefs, changing our beliefs. And I think, oh, yes, that's right. Youth, you do have youth ministry today. I'm sorry, you can be excused. If I asked if you spot on, like, hey, how many of you believe that your beliefs are perfect and you've got right believing in every area, you're accurate, they're perfect, and if anybody in the room said that's okay, then they're probably a liar and probably need to figure out what's wrong with their believing, right? But you know, it's a funny thing when we talk about beliefs, sometimes, especially as Christians, we get so dogmatic, if you will, in, well, that's what I believe in, and I'm not moving on that, and that is what it is. And can I tell you, that's the quickest thing to stop a move of God and what God wants to do in the church and on the earth, is when a group of people say, well, that's my belief, and it is what it is. If you look at every major denomination on the earth, they all were birthed out of revival. What I mean by revival? By a great move of God where thousands and millions of people would come to the gospel, and it was typically birthed out of a new revelation of God. It's always been in God's word, but it was revealed to people, and it would usher in an amazing revival, and lives would be turned around. But typically what happens is the longer those organizations exist, people get dogmatic and, well, that's what how we do it, and that's the way, because that's what worked when revival happened. But how many of you know God is always on the move? And sometimes if we are dogmatic about our belief systems, we can be like those denominations that say, well, that's the way it is. That's how I am. That's what it's going to be. And we miss out on what God wants to do now in our lives and in a now season because we're not willing to evaluate our beliefs and find out, is this helping me or is this hurting me? Amen? Amen. So I think one of the greatest things to help you evaluating your belief system is identify, or having at least an openness of identifying of the beliefs that you hold on to and evaluating, is this producing in my life what I want it to produce? Because what you believe will always produce the direction and outcome of your life. Not the people around you, not what somebody can say to you, not, you know, how many people like you, not what's in your bank. What you believe produces the outcome of your life. Come on, somebody. So if you're not where you want to be, come on, the easiest thing to do is to blame everybody else, right? Like, well, you know, my teacher didn't like me in third grade and it's given me PTSD ever since then. And, you know, now I have a problem with authority because it will grow up a little bit. We're not in third grade anymore, all right? My son's going into fourth grade and that's our big line this summer. You can't do that in fourth grade, right? Like that, they don't play that. My younger daughter, Loretta, is leaving her little, I don't even know what they call it. It's not pre-K because she's going into pre-K, but her little school. And she knows big girl school is coming. And you can't act like that in big girl school. They don't do that in big girl school. And just to remind some of us today, we are in big boy and big girl school. And there are some things that have to change when we get into big girl and big boy school, right? Some beliefs have to change. Some dogmatic things that we've held on to have to change. We need to have an openness and an evaluation of, is this where I want to be? And if it's not, what has brought me here? Well, you know, they looked me over for the raise and nobody's my friend and blah, blah, blah. Well, really, it's a problem in your belief system because you approach the room like a victim. Yeah. Come on, somebody. You walk into the room like a victim and guess how people perceive you? And how many people want to hang around the victims all the time? But when you walk into a room knowing who you are in God, not that you're perfect, not that you have it all together, but knowing that God lives in you, his favor's in you, his goodness is in you, the armies of God are behind you. When you walk into an environment like that, come on, there's something about that. There's an attractiveness to that. People want that. People want to be your friend. They want to give you the job. They want to open doors that no man. Why? Because it's the favor of God on you. So many times in my life, if I was going into a situation that made me nervous or a job interview, I'd write a verse of scripture that applied, you know, something along those lines and put it in my pocket. And when I would feel nervous, I would just touch that piece of paper to remind myself, nope, greater is he that's in me. The armies of heaven walk into this room with me. The same power that raised Christ Jesus from the dead is in me right now. They are blessed to have me in the room. I'm not trying to get a big head on my shoulders. I'm talking about him. Come on, somebody. When I come in, all of heaven comes in with me. And now I walk into the room with some life to give. Not like a sponge just saying, give me, give me, give me, right? But I come in ready to give some life. So what we believe can dramatically affect our situations, can dramatically affect the outcome of our lives. I want to talk a little bit about Jehoshaphat in the Bible. We don't talk about him too much, but he was one of the best and most successful kings in Scripture, right? He was young. He was 35 years old when he became king, and things were going well for Jehoshaphat. He was great. He was wise. God honored him. It was going well for him. He was a success. And then one day, because sometimes there's always that one day, he gets a word telling him, well, that several other kings have come together and they're all coming on at one time to overtake him. They're all coming out as a vast army to overtake him, and they're on their way right now. Because this is not the way trouble always comes. It's always coming right now. It's like, God, give me a week. And it's like, nope, it's coming, and it's coming now. And I can picture in my mind those ancient Judean hillsides and armies just beginning to pour over those hillsides, and Jehoshaphat nervously, like, this is a big confrontation. They are outnumbered on a big scale, right? Like, this is a hard thing for Jehoshaphat. But he gets the news, and your Bible says that rather than running away, he leads his armies towards the battle. Sometimes you're not looking for a fight, but sometimes you have to stand your ground and go towards the adversaries in your life. So while they're on their way to the battle, Jehoshaphat gives very specific instructions to his small, outnumbered army, what would seem insignificant to all the armies that are arrayed against them. And here's what I want you to see. It's in 2 Chronicles 20:20. It's our key scripture for today. So do you think about where he is in this moment, and here's what you're gonna tell your troops. Like, Hollywood does a great job, like, of those big speeches before the troops ride in. Here's his big line, are you ready? Believe in the Lord your God and you will be established. Believe his prophets and you will prosper.
interesting to me. I would have given a speech on, though we are outnumbered, we will fight to our death. We will go down in a blaze of glory. Come on, charge ahead. We will be remembered throughout the ages of those who did not back up. But I love that when he looks at the opposing army and he looks at his troops, the one thing he needs them to know is he said, believe. Believe. Not fight, sharpen your sword, get on a horse. None. Believe in the Lord your God. Believe in his prophets and you will prosper. He's correlating that in the fight of their lives, the most important thing that they can choose to do is believe God in this moment. He's saying there's a lot of things that you can believe right now. You can believe that we are outnumbered. You can believe that there are more against us than are for us. You can believe that this is their final day on planet Earth. You might believe that you'll never see your family again. You might believe, well, all kind of things. But he said, if you believe anything, believe in the Lord your God and believe in his prophets and you will prosper. So all beliefs are not of equal value. All beliefs don't end in the same place or give us the same outcome. Some beliefs will hurt you. Other beliefs will help you. Some beliefs will hold you back. Other beliefs will push you forward. Jehoshaphat is very, very aware that it's so much easier to believe what's smack in front of you, charging at you, ready to overtake you. Come on, I'm preaching to somebody in the house this morning. Then the word of the Lord. Don't look at what's in front of you. Look at what he said to you. You have a choice. What you believe determines your outcome. So it is true on one hand that the army is outnumbered. That in the natural sense, they have no chance of winning the battle. And he knew that that would be the easiest thing for people to believe. But if you can get your belief to look through what you see in the natural and to start looking by faith, he found another truth, and that truth is that the Lord is on their side. And that the Lord has promised to fight for them. And the Lord has promised to save them from their enemies. So Jehoshaphat is saying, in your believing, choose well, choose right. It will determine your outcome. Find the God truth and believe that. If you're taking notes today, you need to know your belief about the battle affects the outcome of the battle. Your belief about the battle affects the outcome of the battle. How you go into a thing is extremely important. First words out of your mouth are extremely important. You can overturn them. You can put a crop failure on negative words spoken. But I want to tell you, when you get bad news or you get some kind of situation in your life, hold your tongue. Don't start saying, oh, this is a death sentence. This is going to end me. This is going to do me. We're going to be through. We're losing the business. We're going to lose the house. We're not going to have anything. Why? Because it's the first response out of your mouth. And how many of you know what comes out of your mouth frames your world? Right? So yeah, you can put a crop failure in that. You can turn around and start speaking right things about your situation. You can do that, but now you got to overcome all that negative junk that you put out. So the best thing is when you receive difficult news is to hold your tongue and say, God, there's a lot of things I can believe here. It's a lot of choices of a lot of outcomes, but I'm not going to say anything until I find what you said. And then I'm going to make my mouth align with what you said. Come on, somebody. Chances are that some of you today are in a battle of your life, or you're in a battle for your life, or maybe you're in a small situation, doesn't really matter. But what you believe about that battle will totally affect the outcome. The battle isn't decided by circumstances. Well, God, you know, they treated me unfairly and that caused me, that don't matter. I heard somebody say a long time ago, you don't need everybody to like you. You need the right people to like you. Come on, somebody. 1,000 can fall at my left hand and 10,000 at my right, but it doesn't have to come near me. Why? Because the right person likes me. I don't need everybody in the company to like me. I need the man who writes the checks and can hand out promotions to like me. That's all that I need. And if he won't do it, God will move him out of the way and give me the company. It's just how you look at your situation, right? So you don't need everybody to like you. You need the right people to like you. So quit being so moved when somebody says, well, you know, they're not my favorite person in the world, or you find out they gossip about you. Who, what, so what, who cares? Move on. God's for us. Who can be against us? It's never decided by circumstances, but always about what we believe about the battle. And it's tempting to focus on the great opposition, that the adversity is too strong, that we're going to go down, that we can't make it. Maybe for some today, the battle is physical sickness, or you've been discouraged, or you just feel like giving up or throwing in the towel on something that you were meant to do. But that's not how your story's going to end, is it? You're going to find what God said, and that's what you're going to do. So I want to remind you today to not give up, not quit, don't give in, because it's not your battle anyway. It's always been God's, and it's always been on his shoulders, and it's always been about him, right? So it's not even my situation. All that I am required to do is believe. That word believe is repeated over and over and over and over again in your Bible. Believe. That with God's help, I can go from strength to strength. That with God's help, if I believe right, I can go from one level of glory to another level. And I have to have right believing about myself. And listen, this gets a little sticky sometimes. And I remember when I first heard, I think it was Melody Hilton, teaching on this, I thought, well, that's kind of, it was revolutionary for me. But the more I listened to it and studied, I thought, you know, that's right. Because in the natural can err on the side of self-humanism. And we certainly don't want that, because without God, we are nothing. But Melody did a teaching that we did at the church several years ago. But it talked about honoring God's creation. And honoring you as God's creation. You know, we talk so much about honoring everybody else, and yes, and that's important. We honor that gifting, we honor that person. But don't forget, God created you in his image. And when he designed you perfect. And he looked at the circumference of your life and he said, this is what they're gonna need. They're gonna need to have this personality. They're gonna have to have that boldness. They're gonna have to have that meekness, whatever it is. And he packaged you up and planted you in the earth for a specific time as this. And then on top of that, graced you with an anointing to accomplish that which he has called you to do, right? So it doesn't help God, if we walk around and start going, well, I'm just, you know, me, it's just not great. I don't have the ability. I don't have the talent. I'm not skilled enough. Let me back this up for a minute. The women's ministry yesterday got together, and I got the dreaded text from my wife, Sarah. If you know anything about our marriage, you know that we aren't good crafters nor painters. But every time Hope City Church does these little paint things, I have to find somewhere in my home to hang these paint things. And so over the years, as we've moved, they've been in the basement, they've been in a closet, and now we have decided that all the things that she paints goes in our bathroom, and we did a couples one, if you remember, a few years back. So yesterday I get a picture, and it's that blank canvas, and I just put my head down. I said, oh God, no. Listen, we're honest with each other about our skill set. I'll go to make something, and she's not shy about saying, that's not supposed to make that noise when you open it. And I'm like, probably not, but so we laugh about it. So, but anyway, they all did a beautiful job, and you can see the paintings in the lobby that they did. But I said that, you know, is we are God's painting. We're his masterpiece. And how degrading to the Lord to look at your even self in the mirror and say, I don't like it. I don't like it. I don't like the way I look. I don't like the way I sound. I don't like my hair. I don't like my skin. I don't like any of it. He says, you're my masterpiece. You were created beautiful. You were created in my image. How could we look at ourselves and say to ourselves, I'm not skilled enough. I don't have the ability. I can't do that. When God says, I've designed you for that purpose. I've designed you to be the mother or the father, the husband and the wife that I know that you can be. I've designed you to lead that business. I've designed you to teach in that classroom. I've designed you to excel in whatever realm of life that I've called you. That's my design. And though we think humility is us saying, well, look at me, poor me, I am nothing. Moses wrote about himself that I am the most humble man who has ever lived. Think about that. Doesn't quite sound like a humble man, because that's, we think humility is self-degradation. Like, let me tear myself down so much so that I can prove to myself and everybody else that I'm a humble person. No, humility is strength in control. Which means I walk into the room and I know in the power of Jesus, I can do anything. I know I can run this business. I know I can do it. Now, he hasn't put me at the top, so I'm gonna serve that business owner until he does. And I'm gonna give it, I'm gonna restrain my strength, but I know who I am in God. Come on, somebody. So quit talking about yourself in negative ways. Quit thinking about yourself in negative ways. You do a dishonor to God when you do that. And yes, without him, we are helpless and hopeless. But guess what? We're not without him. We're not without him. Come on, we've got him on the inside of us. I want you to listen here to David's psalm in Psalms 3, verse 1. He says, "O Lord, how many are my foes? Many are rising against me. Many are saying of my soul, there is no salvation for him in God." Come on, he's facing something. He's going through something. We all feel like that. But, come on, you, O Lord. Do you see, it's not denying facts. Jehoshaphat didn't look at the hillside and say, "What armies?" He saw them. They were there. David, in his writing, he's not saying, "Lord, all your foes have disappeared. I don't know where they are." He's saying, "There are many foes. They're rising against me. They're even saying of me, there's no hope for me in God. I see the facts. But you, O Lord, art a shield about me, my glory and the lifter of my head." Here, do you see where he's turning his believing? It's easy to believe that the foes are against me and I'll be overcome, but he chooses his belief and he says, "But you, O Lord, you're the shield, you're the glory." It says, "I cried aloud to the Lord and he answered me from his holy hill. I lay down and slept. I awoke again, for the Lord sustained me. I will not be afraid of many thousands of people who have set themselves against me all around. Arise, O Lord, save me, O my God." Do you see that? Do you see where he chooses his belief? He chooses his outcome? And sometimes when you wake up in the morning and things are going wrong, you have one of those days, like today for our family. If you see Bob after church, just don't be shocked when you see him in just a t-shirt and a diaper running around. I got here earlier and Sarah pulled up afterwards and I went to help bring the kids in, and as he's running towards the church, she said, "Jim, look at the back of his pants." And he had a blowout. And only parents know what I'm talking about. And I said, "Do we have any other shorts?" "Mm-mm." I said, "We can try to run home and get them quick." "No, I don't think we have time." So it is what it is, right? It is what it is. So when you see Bob running around with just a diaper on, just know what happened, all right? "Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers us out of them all." So I was just glad that Sarah chose to change it and didn't ask me to do it. You know, it's one of those things in marriage, you're like, "Please, please, please don't ask." And I was like, "Thank God." Anyway, let me read this quote to you real quick. But listen, it says this: "If you think you're beaten, you are. If you think you dare not, you don't. If you like to win, but you think you can't, you almost certain that you won't. If you think you're lose, you're lost. For out of the world, we find success begins with a person's will. It's all in the state of mind. If you think you're outcast, you are. If you think you don't have what it takes to rise, you won't. But if a man thinks he can win, he always will." I know that's a worldly quote, but listen to what Jesus said in Mark 9:23. Everything is possible for the one who believes. Go back to the first word. Everything. Everything is possible for those who believe. What you believe, you will see. So if you don't like what you see this morning, change what you believe. You can stay right where you are and live out your life right where you are. Victim of circumstance, victim of people. The world's against me. There is no hope. There is no help. Or you can push the plate back from your table, square your shoulders, step up and say, I'm not a victim. Maybe in the world's eyes, sure, but I'm a victor through Christ. I can do anything. I can do all things because he's for me. It's all about perspective. The higher you go in God, it changes your perspective. The higher you go up in elevation, it changes your perspective. That's why it's so important when we worship. Why? Because it lifts us from what we came in with our perspective, how we're seeing life, how our week went, where we're going. And we come into a room like this and we worship God with the saints and we're declaring the same thing together. And suddenly the presence of God rushes in and our perspective changes. And suddenly that thing just doesn't seem as insurmountable anymore. And suddenly I have hope. And suddenly depression runs out of the room. Why? Because I've changed my perspective. So what you believe is the beginning of your reality. What you believe about God affects your relationship with God. Some people believe that God is standing in heaven with a hammer ready for you to mess up. And the moment that you do, judgment's coming on your life. So they live with this kind of relationship with God where it's like, oh no, I better not. And if I mess up, oh, it's a terrible, terrible thing. The full judgment of God was poured out on Jesus Christ on the cross. Come on, you are a recipient of grace. So when you mess up, I can approach God boldly in his presence and ask for forgiveness and he covers my sin. But wrong believing affects that. Your beliefs about your marriage affect your marriage. I heard somebody say this week, and I thought it was so good. They said, you know, typically when you marry someone, you marry them because they have 80% of what you love. Like 80% about that person. Man, I love the way they smile. I love the way they talk. I love how they think. I love 80%. And probably even, you know, in those early days of marriage, you can find 20% in there. I don't really love that about them. But you're just so in love with that 80%, right? That you're just like head over heels. But they talk about typically when infidelity happens in a marriage, it happens because somebody goes out and finds somebody who has the 20% that their spouse doesn't. Maybe the 20% where it's like, well, they affirm me. I don't really like their 80%, but they got that 20% that I've been missing. And they make life-altering decisions that will forever affect their families, their home, their children, all because their perspective changed. Instead of saying, you know what? This week, that 20% is really getting on my nerves. But I got to go back to the 80. And I got to start looking. And I got to start believing, you know what? I still love that about them. And sometimes you have to recount out loud that 80% of what you love about that person. You know what? I love the way they cook that meal. Even if you got to break it down to the small. Why? Because what it's doing is it's changing your perspective. Are you seeing that? If all I'm doing is, I can't believe she didn't do that again. I can't believe they didn't take out the trash. I can't believe he let the car on empty. And you just dwell there and you just think about those things. Suddenly it's brewing in you and your belief system about that person. You know what? They are out to get me. They've never wanted to support me in my career. They never wanted to support me in my business. They don't really appreciate what I do as a father. And all of a sudden you are building this whole kingdom out of the 20% that is just rubbing you wrong. But in those moments, if you catch what you believe and start saying, no, God put me with that person and I'm going to remember why I love that person. I'm going to remember and I'm going to say them and I'm going to speak them and I'm going to believe them. Suddenly your perspective about that person changes. And now when they walk into the room, It's different. I had to apologize to Sarah last night. It's not why I'm preaching that, but she said she was going to call in our to-go food order after we put the kids to bed at 6:30. She texted me at 7:30 and said, I just called it in. They said it would be like 90 minutes, but I'm sure you can go a little early. And I already went, oh, that's late now. Now we're 2 hours out. I don't know why you didn't call it in. You said you're going to call it in. So I get there to pick it up and they're like, well, no, we told the lady on the phone it would be 90 minutes. So you have to sit here and wait at that point 45 minutes. So by the time I got the food and got it home, I said, here's your food. I'm going out to the fire. Leave me alone. Now, I came back in. I said, I apologize. I'm tired and I'm hungry. I don't know why you didn't call it in at 6:30, but I'm tired and I'm hungry. All right. So I don't know why we talk about those things, but oh, that's why. Because what you believe about other people will affect your relationship with other people. It affects your relationship. Don't let those 20% moments that irk you cause you to believe something that's not true. What you believe about other people will affect you, how your relationships with other people. If you walk into a room, like I said earlier, and believe that everyone is against you, that's how you're going to perceive everything that's said. I've seen this so much in pastoring through the years where it's like you can have an event and you think everybody's friendly and somebody else, one person out of the group says, I didn't like how you said that and I felt like it was a personal attack. And you're like, what are you talking about? Like, I didn't wake up this morning and say, you know what, I'm preaching about her this morning and I'm going to make sure that she gets the message, right? Like, no, that's not how it happened. But sometimes people walk into a room and they will look for any excuse. They're ready for the fight. Come on, somebody. They're like, you half look at me wrong and I'm ready. I'm ready. But again, and then it's no surprise. See, this is what happens. Every time I go somewhere, people just come in. You walked into the room ready. You were looking for it. Your belief brought it into your reality. But if I can catch myself at the door and say, you know what? I believe I'm going in the house of God's people today. I believe that the favor of God is on those people. I believe I'm going to be blessed in that place. I believe I'm worshiping with brothers and sisters who are with me in the fire through the thick and the thin. We're not just acquaintances, but we are a church family doing life together, living together, praying together, breathing together. Come on, this is who we are. You will walk into the room different. And now, instead of waiting for someone to come talk to me, you are giving life and talking to other people. Amen? One thing I thought was interesting is Elon Musk, who is currently the richest man in the world. He's worth over $200 billion. One thing I thought I've read that was interesting about him is he had a very difficult childhood. He moved around a lot. He was originally from South Africa and then moved to Canada, but he says that he was bullied in school. He got beat up a lot, didn't have a lot of friends. But today, his companies build electric cars and rockets. And in an interview that he did, he said his goal is to land the first humans on Mars. Pretty lofty goal. And again, I think it's so interesting of his background because it would be so easy to fall into that, woe is me, I'll never amount to anything. But if you change what you believe, you can do anything, right? But the interviewer asked Elon Musk, he said, why do you want to grow, what do you want to do when you get to Mars? And he said, I want to plant a garden. And the interviewer was like, you know, afterwards was commenting and they're like, oh yeah, I thought, well, probably he's going to solve world hunger. Like, you know, this is what he's going to do. But when they asked him, why do you want to plant a garden on Mars? He said, simply to take a picture, get back in my aircraft and go home. Okay. Well, why? He said, because I don't have to populate Mars. All I have to do is show people and get people to believe that there is life on Mars. And if I can get them to believe that there's life on Mars, their belief will get them to Mars on their own. Just pause to think about that for a minute. What he's saying is, because people believe that there is no life on Mars, they believe that it's impossible. So if I can show them a picture that life is possible on Mars, the power of their belief will cause them to not be able to stay away from it. What wisdom? I know, but that's in your Bible. Like, that's Jesus, right? Like, if you can just believe it, it's possible. Right? So, and I just love that. It's like, if we can just get people to believe, their belief will not keep them away. Like, you go back to the Tower of Babel, which it says that they were literally trying to build a tower to God, to heaven. And do you know what the weirdest thing in your Bible is? It says that unless the Lord had disrupted their language, they would have done it. Well, now that can't be what it meant, because you know, you have outer space, you have the solar system, they didn't have spacesuits, they didn't have any of that stuff. So surely that's not what it meant. It's what it meant. Because they were unified in their belief, God said they would do it. They would do it. So what do you believe today? You know, again, as we sang, these are dark days in our world. These are hard times. Political climate is in upheaval again. People are walking away from the church in droves. But what do we believe? Like that old book says, they were the worst of times, but they were the best of times. It might be dark times, but if you believe that we are the voice in the wilderness crying out, prepare ye the way of the Lord, well, then these are the best of times. Because people only come hungry when they're starving. Yeah, people come hungry when they're starving. Right? So maybe the shakeup we see in the world isn't a throw up our hands and say, where's God and woe is me? Maybe it's God setting the platform with what Pastor Don has been trying to teach us on Wednesday nights, which you need to get your butt here on Wednesday nights, by the way, is what she's been trying to teach us is that the harvest is ripe for the taking. See, if we're looking at the world and we're saying, well, you know, they hate Christians and they hate people and anyone who talks about Jesus, they just hate. They're going to hate me. They're going to revile me. But you know, when you approach it like that, guess that's probably who you're going to find. But when you approach it like, my neighbors are so hungry for the things of God. My family is so hungry for the things of God. They are fed up with watching every political turn, but they're so fed up with the government. They're so fed up with our economy. They don't have money even to pay their bills anymore. Like, I don't even know how people can survive with the current amount of PPL electric rates. Could I got anybody else in the room? No. I'll tell you, when my kids leave the basement light on, there's 12 light bulbs in that basement. And I pull up and I see that basement light on. But could it be that God is setting the stage for the greatest revival that this earth has ever seen? Could it be that we are walking on the edge of the fire of God taking over our churches like never before? See, that's why when we come into a worship space and they're like, oh, they're singing the chorus again, would they just move on? Why are they just standing there quiet after that song? I don't know. It's because we're just getting ready. We're just saying, Lord, bring it, send the fire, open it up. I got to change my beliefs. If I'm ready for one song in and out, a short sermon, poem, and then be on my way, I'm going to miss what God wants to do, but I'm open for what God wants to do. Why? Because we are living in the best times of the church. We are living in the best times for Hope City. God's opening doors. He's not only opening earthly doors for us. Come on, somebody. He's going to begin to open. I'm prophesying to you now. He's going to begin to open the windows of heaven over this place, and we're going to experience the fire and power of God like we've never experienced before. Where now it won't take 3 months and a prophecy team to get that thing out of you. It's going to take a God encounter at this altar, and in a moment, what man could not do, God will do for you in a moment. Why? Because that's what we are getting ready to see. So when I come to church and I believe that and I think that, and that's what I'm coming prepared for, they don't got to sing my song, it don't have to be in my key. The drummer can be off beat and the singer can be off key, but it doesn't matter, because I'm ready and I'm hungry. I know what I've come anticipating. I know what I'm feasting on today. You don't need to encourage me. I'm encouraged all by myself, because I came in the room ready. I came ready. I came believing. Quit walking into your job going, oh, another Monday, another Monday. Can I just remind you that your purpose on earth is not to punch a time clock? So if God puts you in that job, it's probably more about the people than it is the money. It might be because God wants you to be there to have an effect on people and to win people and to save people and be a light to people. And just as a result, he provides some income through it for you. But he owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. Do you think he really needs that little job to provide for you? He can just, like he did for the disciples, a coin in the fish's mouth just appeared. He owns the gold in all of these hills. Come on, somebody. So when he's put you somewhere, instead of approaching it like a hard thing and a task, man, I get ready. I'm coming in. God's coming in. I know they're mean in that break room. I know they say some things in that break room. But when I walk in, God's walking in. The power of God's walking in. His presence is walking in. The fire is walking in. Get ready. I'm eating more today than just a sub. And that's why Jesus said, listen, if you only believe, just believe. How you believe, how you approach it, will determine the outcome. So if something in your life's just not working, if something in your life's been it's like a hard thing, it's a heavy thing, can I just challenge us today? Re-examine that thing. Find the God voice in that thing. Figure out that 80%. Figure out why God has you on that job. Figure out why God has you in that situation. Figure out why God's called you to this or that. Instead of complaining about it and running your mouth about it, figure out why God has you there and excel at it. Approach it with belief. Have we improved in our beliefs in the last week, month, year? If not, it's time we examine what we truly believe. Back to our story to wrap it up this morning, and team, you can come. 2 Chronicles 20, 21 to 22. After Jehoshaphat admonishes his troops to believe in the Lord, believe in his prophets, believe in what God said. Don't look to the left, to the right, just believe in what God said. Don't be discouraged when they said it's not working. Believe in what God said. He goes on and says, Jehoshaphat appointed the men to sing to the Lord and praise him for the splendor of his holiness. And as they went out, they heard of the army saying, give thanks to the Lord, for his love endures forever. And as they begin to sing and praise, the Lord set ambushes. The Lord set ambushes. How did they win when they were outnumbered? They believed and they praised. Do you know why praise is important to your believing? Because if I wrote you a $1 million check right now, nobody in the room would be like, who did he just give the check to? You would be spinning and dancing and screaming and rejoicing and shouting. I mean, it may not clear, so check that postmark date, but why? Because you received. But Jesus says, I can act like I received before I received, because believing is the same as receiving. Why? Believing is faith. Faith is the assurance of things that are coming. So though I don't see the marriage restored yet, maybe, though my finances haven't changed, though not everything in my life looks right, and though, you know, maybe there are still some hard days, as long as I can get my praise, as long as I can believe, as long as I can stretch up my hands, what am I doing? I'm showing God, I'm acting like it's already happened. I'm praising like it's already done. I'm putting my shout on, I'm getting my praise on, I'm getting my dance on like you've already done it. Why? Because I believe that you will. And that's how I'm approaching the room. That's how I'm approaching church. That's how I'm approaching faith. And that's how I'm approaching every area of my life. One last scripture, Psalms 112, verse 7. It's been a foundational scripture for me. I love this because I think we live so often here. But it says, he is not afraid of bad news. You know what that means? I'm not living waiting for the other shoe to drop. If I'm honest, I was telling the team, I said, even with Jason Crabb, I was telling the elders team this week, I said, even with Jason Crabb coming, you know, my flesh is like, but what if nobody comes? That's my flesh. I know that. And there's that part of my personality in the natural that could always be waiting for the other shoe to drop, waiting for the bad news. But no, I got a hold of this and I said, I will fear no bad news. I don't walk into a room waiting for bad news. I don't walk into the doctor's office waiting for bad news. And even if they got some for me, it's all right, because that thing is subject to change when it comes into alignment with the word of God, right? So let's leave here not waiting for bad news, not fearing any bad news, but his heart is firm, trusting in the Lord. Father, I thank you today for this word. I thank you for what you're stirring in us here at Hope City. I believe that this is a summer that will be marked by fire, that this is a summer that will be marked by explosive outpourings of the power and presence of God. I believe that at the end of this summer, we will be unidentifiable from who we were before, because what you are going to do in this place. So I thank you that even in this moment, you're setting our hearts on fire to receive all that it is that you have for us, all that it is that you want to do for us, Father. We give you a resounding yes, even when it's uncomfortable. We say yes. Can you say yes with me? Yes, we receive it, God, in Jesus' name. Have your will and have your way. We approach the room in faith, believing you're gonna do what it is that you said you would do. In Jesus' name, let's stand to our feet and worship the Lord.
You're constant, I witnessed it, and I'm confident.